Hello and welcome to our webinar. My name is Bartosz Nowopolski and I'm representing AVSystem's marketing team. It is my real pleasure to be your host today. Thank you so much for joining us. Today, we will demonstrate the deep integration of Anjay Lightweight M2M SDK and Coiote IoT Device Management Platform, the two leading lightweight M2M device management solutions with the STMicroelectronics development environment. Before we start, I would like to remind you of a few things. Today's session will be recorded. We will be sharing the recording with you afterwards. Also, on the top right-hand corner, you will find a question tab. Feel free to use it during the webinar to submit any questions you may have. We will try to answer all of the questions at the end of the webinar during the Q&A session. And without further ado, let me start today's session by introducing our speakers. Marcin Nodge, Product Director for IoT at AVSystem.
Hello, welcome everybody.
Hello Marcin, it's good to have you with us. Mieszko Mieruński, Embedded Team Lead.
Hello everyone.
And Solofonia Razavintrahaba, Vertical Marketing Cellular Group Leader, Microcontroller Division, STMicroelectronics.
Hello everyone, welcome.
Guys, I am super excited about today's amazing conversation that we are going to have. I'm giving the voice over to Solofo to start us off. Solofo, over to you.
Yeah, thank you very much. So basically, I would like to introduce two slides about, let's say, the challenge of IoT in general and what are the problems we are trying to solve here. And the second slide will introduce what are the solutions that we are trying to promote here actually. So basically, in this first slide, I try to summarize the IoT challenges, what are the problems that the end customer and the developer need to address to develop an IoT solution and to deploy as a product. So basically, first, the IoT developer needs to understand what kind of application I want to run on my device. Should I do a local processing or should I do a local processing at the cloud side? So basically here, the developer needs to understand which kind of application processing need to, let's say, to embed in my device. So this is the first key question to address. The second is the sensing and the actuating, because in the end, the IoT needs to monitor the physical environment. So you need to integrate some sensors, actuators to control the environment. So basically, the application needs to control the sensors and actuators that is part of the device. And the second challenge is to identify what are the connectivity that I'm going to use with my device. I may have a local connectivity, which are, controlling local sensors, but I need also a connectivity allowing my device to connect to the cloud. So basically, there is a question here, which kind of technology I'm going to use to my device. So this is one of the key questions that an IoT device maker has to address and to solve. Now you can have the connectivity, the sensing and application, but you need to protect the device because thanks to the local interface that exposing the device to the, local attacker, there is a need to enforce the security of the device to protect the firmware inside the device. And also there is a need to have a security solution to, protect the access, to the internet, meaning that you need to protect the data that you are going to send to the cloud. Then in addition to that, there is a need power management because some devices are, battery powered. So here we need to have a power management solution that is part of the device. So these are, the key features that need to address and to clearly solve by the IoT device maker to make a product. But on top of that, we need also a development environment. So meaning here that we need a kind of platform that allows to make a quick prototyping. So here, the developer need, this kind of evaluation kit development platform and also development environment to, you know, to generate the binary that will run in the application MCU. So this is, let's say, the key, let's say, features that need to address at device level. But on top of this, let's say, a challenge that need to address at device level, there is need also to have a connection to the cloud. Okay, so here we need to have an internet connection. So the IoT developer needs to think about what kind of technology I'm going to use. Should I use, let's say, direct connection to the cloud, such as a cellular? Or should we take some other technology like Wi-Fi or other technologies that need a gateway? So also, even if the developer decide to integrate the cellular connectivity, they have to find out which kind of technology I'm going to use. CAT-M and NB-IoT, that is, let's say, providing the better performance for my my device to address the low power and also to support, let's say, the security feature that I want to apply to protect, let's say, my device. Also, the level of, let's say, coverage, should I plan to deploy my device into a specific region or global region, global, let's say, coverage. So these are many, there are many questions that the, let's say, IoT developer need to address to select the internet connectivity that should be, let's say, used for each product. And in the end, try to go here. Okay. Try to move. There are some blocks inside this call services here. So can you move? Yeah, thank you. Yeah, okay, thank you very much. So in the end, you can have the internet connection, you have the device, but you need also a cloud services. So here for the data orchestration, you need to process the data that has been reported by the device. You need to integrate the, let's say, the device inside the enterprise infrastructure, such as Azure, AWS. And also you need to, let's say, implement a solution for the device management to update the device firmware and to control, let's say, remotely the device. So all these are, let's say, one of the key challenges that an IoT developer and the company has to address to have, let's say, operational IoT device. Okay, so the next slide is, let's say, showing what are the how do we tackle this, these challenges and how, or I would say, how to help our IoT developers and companies to quickly, let's say, address all this item in, let's say, a safe way and in a simple way, meaning that thanks to this, let's say, the solution we are bringing up, we help all the, let's say, these companies developing a solution to come up with, let's say, a solution that can be deployed in the market. Okay, so first of all, we divide, let's say, the, let's say, the problem here, the challenges into different groups. So maybe you can move on because there are missing some components here. Yeah, sorry, thank you. Okay, so in the, we have divided, maybe, please, Martin, can you, there are still some, yeah. So maybe I can show all the, yeah, please. Okay, thank you very much. So let's divide the solution in three, I would say, two parts. One is the low part, which is called the key components. And on top of this is the, let's say, the cloud service. So ST tried to provide the key components that help the developer to, let's say, to have a kind of a generic solution that is able to connect to internet. So to achieve that, we are providing the chipset, including IoT peripherals like sensors, local connectivity, Bluetooth, NFCs, and also, let's say, environmental sensors, power management, and even we can support as well, long-range connectivity. So basically, we provide a complete IoT peripherals allowing to easily, let's say, develop a solution. And then we provide the application MCU. We have more than 1,000 part numbers, allowing then the end developer and customer and developer to select the MCU that will fit in better, let's say, their product need. And then we work with also modem vendors, modem partners, to provide a selection of a few modem as a part of our ecosystem. And then on top of that, you need SIM cards. So ST has also a SIM card solution where we can program the profile of operator that should be used to, let's say, to enable the connectivity to the cloud. Then, aside this chipset that can be embedded in the device, we provide also an ecosystem here as a part of the development environment. So we provide a hardware platform, which allows the developer or company to make a quick demonstration or proof of concept. And then on top of that, we provide the tools, which is, built around the STM32 cube. And then, this is, let's say, the bricks that is coming from ST. And to enable the connectivity, we work with partner. So here we are, let's say, working with key partners such as a TrueFone to provide the connectivity to internet. And we have also a solution where the SIM card is integrated in the modem. So we have a modem from Sequence, for example, here. Which is have an embedded SIM card from Orange. And last week we have announced also our partnership with Sierra Wireless, which is providing their connectivity. So thanks to this partnership with the key player, we provide the key components to let the device to have an access to internet. Now the missing block is the cloud part. So that's why here we are invited. We are very happy to work with the AVSystem, which is our, a long-standing partner from the beginning of the cellular adventure. So AVSystem has developed the lightweight machine-to-machine technology. At the beginning of this cellular activity, still we think that lightweight machine-to-machine is the key technology to leverage, the power of the cellular. Meaning that lightweight machine-to-machine, provide the better protocol to fit with the cellular technology. So I let AVSystem team to introduce more on the lightweight machine-to-machine. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Merci. I give you the floor.
So before we go deeply into our solution and our solution for lightweight machine to machine that we are providing within the ST Micro ecosystem, I'd like to say a couple of words about our company. So AVSystem has been on the market for already 15 years, so we are already quite a mature company. However, for the majority of our time, we have been operating in the telco market, providing solutions for device management of telco equipment. However, in the recent years, we are moving towards IoT in addition to the telco business. And as part of this, we are the leaders and the front runners in terms of popularization and providing solutions for lightweight machine-to-machine devices. As you can see, we are available across all continents, except for Antarctica, the R&D headquarters are in Poland, and we have also our business offices in different parts of the world. In terms of our product portfolio, our two most important components for IoT is our Anjay, which is the lightweight machine-to-machine client SDK, and Coiote IoT Device Management platform, which is like the server part for lightweight machine-to-machine server. In addition to this, we also provide other products like UMP, Unified Device Management, Service Assurance, DHCP servers, which are mostly focused on the telco markets, Wi-Fi added services, and also an application enablement platform also working within the IoT space. However, during this presentation, we focus solely on Anjay and the Coiote Device Management platform. A little about our ecosystem that we are building, about our customers and partners. So we are working with, firstly, with the connectivity providers, and this is, you know, something where we are very strong because of our long-standing history working with the telco operators. Among our partners are AT&T, Bell Canada, Vodafone, SoftBank, as well as, which are, you know, the well-established telco companies, as well as the virtual operators like Truefone that are also very strong within the IoT domain. In terms of the device side partnership, we are working with chipset vendors, with OEMs, here especially STMicro, Nordic Semiconductor, Sequans, Talens, and many others. And as for our enterprises, we have solutions deployed for Vaisala, Traxsense, Toropak, Pisense, all of these companies. In addition, we are also trying to have a strong position within the alliances, especially within the OMA spec work, which is the standardization body standing behind the lightweight machine-to-machine protocol. In addition, we have this IMC council, and also since the beginning of this year, we are also contributors to the Zephyr project, the popular embedded operating system. A couple of words about our customers. So first of all, Traxsense. This is a company that is doing asset tracking for supply chain. What is very important here is that Traxsense is also building their devices based on the STM32 chipsets. That's why this STM32 logo is present here. Not all of our customers, of course, are using STM chipsets, but we also want to emphasize that we have customers working already within the STM32 environment. What is interesting about Traxsense is that this asset tracking, the containers are being shipped. So this is a global service where the geolocation is very important and the safety and security of the containers. So lots of containers that are being shipped, monitored. There is a need for doing this direct management as well as doing some operations on edge, especially in the areas like in the middle of the ocean where there is no cellular connectivity. So there has to be this balance for cellular connectivity and as well as satellite connectivities. And as part of this, it's also very important for them to have a very efficient solution since the costs of transmission over the satellite is quite expensive. That's why Traxsense is pushing very heavily on optimizing this connectivity, even to the level of avoiding DTLS handshake as much as possible. Another interesting customer for us is the Finnish company called Vaisala, and they are a global leaders in the environmental and industrial measurement. This customer is very much focused on the security aspect of their solutions, and we consider them to be, you know, really on the cutting edge of the security part for IoT. They are providing solutions for these measurements together, Anjay and Coiote, as one solution. What they are mostly focused about is this concept of zero-touch device provisioning, certificate management, and also very efficient communication between devices and their own infrastructure. Storopak is another interesting company of us, customer of us, and this Storopak is building smart packaging solutions for the shipping companies. So they are the sort of package fillers, and Amazon is one of their customers. And what is important for them is the management and monitoring of these machines that are manufacturing these package fillers. devices, again, deployed across all continents with CAT-M1 uplinks. Sometimes even there are environments where this cellular connectivity is also not available. So again, very much challenged deployment environment in terms of the connectivity. And again, thanks to, this is all possible thanks to the lightweight machine-to-machine and especially Anjay and Coiote together. And finally, PySense, again, STM32 customer. It's a smart metering solution provider. In this sense, PySense is the manufacturer of the smart metering devices, but also provider of the services. Again, they need to have device management in order to manage and monitor the devices that they are leasing. Scenario in which they're operating is quite similar to how StoroPack is working. They have deployments for LTE-M and as well as NB-IoT networks. So now the core of this webinar, the core of the value of the product value that we are providing is about device management. And we start by arguing that device management is a must. And it is a must for any IoT, successful IoT solution. However, it's a part of the service that is very often ignored by the enterprises, IoT enterprises, especially in the very beginning. Why is that? The answer is quite obvious. It doesn't bring any measurable business value to begin with. And this is very similar problem to what we are seeing also in other aspects of creating solutions. So for example, security is a similar, has a similar problem. Very often we are building a service and we just consider, okay, let's not focus on the security. Let's focus on shipping this to the market, start making money, and then we will be worrying about the security. System monitoring is also an interesting use case that in the past has been often ignored by the service providers. The providers were just saying, okay, let's deploy it. Let's hope nothing will happen and let's worry about the monitoring later. However, in terms of security and system monitoring, there has been already a growing awareness about importance of introducing these two features in the very beginning of building a successful service, not only IoT service, but any service. And we hope to bring the same level of awareness for device management as well for the IoT solutions. And by device management, we mean all of the functionalities that allow for the remote execution of procedures on devices with regards to doing some remote diagnostics, establishing connectivity, collecting devices, providing security, doing device provisioning, as well as the over-the-air services required for upgrading the device firmware or device software. The reality at the moment is that device management is often introduced late. It is also very often mistaken with the data orchestration process. And as a result of introducing this late, the problem is that the solution is really not well thought through. And if you are forced to introduce it because of the external circumstances, not well thought through, sometimes you go for what is the cheapest possible option. You buy something that is a closed solution, so you may be ending up in the situation where you have this vendor locking case. And again, the next consequence of this is the poor interoperability of your solution, your devices with other devices, other classes of devices, and so on. And in the end, you may end up in a situation which is an operational nightmare. And very often we hear this feedback, or like this opinions from the customers that we are talking to, is that, we didn't think about it earlier, then we were forced to, and now our ops team is managing 5 or 10 classes of devices. They need to be trained and educated in order to understand the subtle differences of how they work. And this just, doesn't scale up. It's not building, a reliable, well working service for us, and that there are just regrets about it. So what could be an alternative? In order to avoid the vendor locking situation, we should be looking at the standardized device management solutions, and lightweight machine-to-machine is one example of it. What are the core features of it? And the most important, in my opinion, is the well-defined data model. This data model is a set of objects that are openly available, peer-reviewed by the lightweight machine-to-machine community, so that that are allowing you, or like as a device manufacturer or a service provider, to map a state of the device remotely into on the device management server. So, for example, it's very easy to. There is an object called, for example, device, that is describing what kind of device it is, what is possible with this device, and so on. And because it's an open source, peer-reviewed solution, you should have this confidence, you know, that as approved by the body, there have been, you know, lots of minds looking at it, thinking about it, understanding if this is providing a value, discovering the corner cases, and so on. So instead of thinking about reinventing the wheel and thinking how to model your device, you could cut your time and start using this well-defined data model provided by lightweight M2M. The second important thing is that it's not only about device management, because it's a protocol that is combining both device management and data collection together in order to provide a very efficient communication, both in terms of the amount of data that it is being sent, exchanged between the device and the server, but also in terms of the consumption, like the transmission time, which has direct impact on the energy saving capabilities for a device, which is also an important aspect. Second, the next thing is that it already has this security capabilities that has been designed from the very beginning and not added later into it, which is also a very important thing. It provides bindings for non-IP networks as well, not only for the IP network. So for these solutions that are very well, that needs very high level of optimization, where sending or using the IP and TCP or UDP layer is not feasible, then non-IP is an interesting option. Lightweight machine to machine can be serving such deployments. It's efficient communication consumption already, we talked about it. And finally, it has very well defined workflows for doing device provisioning. And this is also a very important thing, since other solutions like CoAP, MQTT, AMQP do not have them defined. So even if you are not so much concerned about your efficiency of your communication, all of these things that we have discussed earlier, it might be also interesting for you to look at it just from the perspective of doing an efficient and scalable device provisioning using lightweight machine to machine. However, if there is only one way, like a one sentence summary, that we should think about lightweight machine to machine and where it is applicable, there is a growing consensus within the device manufacturers that this is the only way for device to cloud communication operating in the LP1 networks. So what is the current market situation of lightweight machine to machine? And it is very popular among mobile operators, but for doing radio module management. However, its adoption among enterprises is still quite low. So if we look at the curve of the diffusion of innovation, we can see that there are already some companies like Vaisala, Elvaco, TrackSense, that have already adopted lightweight machine to machine. They have adopted because they recognize that they have a problem, and lightweight machine to machine is a technology that can help solve them this problem. However, as we see, there is still, you know, a lot of things that needs to be done in order for lightweight machine to machine to become a mainstream market solution, even to go into this early majority market. So we can see there is this chasm, and the reason behind this chasm, we believe, or we set this hypothesis, that it is because it is really difficult for developers to understand and start using it very quickly. So based on this, we stated the following problem, what we as AVSystem can do to reduce this entrance barrier for lightweight machine to machine. And we would like then now to introduce Anjay, our lightweight machine-to-machine client, so that you understand, you know, what value it brings. Then we'll talk about Coiote, and then we can say how these two together, and then provide an interesting value for the STM32 development environment. So there are these three pillars for that we develop Anjay along. First is about usability. So for usability, we are producing and publishing these open source integrations for popular STM32 developer boards. It is interoperable with different cellular modems that are being provided for STMicro. We are also providing an integration testing platform, which allows developer to test their integration of their solution with the device our device management platform. And then gain the confidence that they can that they need in order to deploy devices to the field. And then we are also would like to announce that we are going to publish the component called iCube Anjay, which will become part of the STM32 CubeMX. We'll talk in details about this component later in this presentation. In terms of security, which is the second pillar that we are building, we are focusing a lot on the secure communication. For this, we are providing very deep integrations with the existing popular cryptographic libraries. We provide support for the OSCOR protocol, which is the end-to-end security protocol for the lightweight machine-to-machine communication between the device and the server. We are also providing solutions and as part of our integrations for the secure credentials management. So here we talk about integrations with the hardware security module, using the PKCS11 interface, as well as we are having a support for IoT Safe standard. This is the standard which treats SIM card as a root of trust, where credentials for the communication can be safely stored. This part is available as within Anjay. And finally, there is this platform security architecture by ARM. We already provide support for it. And within the STM32 ecosystem, this is going to appear soon as part of the STM32 U5 developer board. All in all, what we are aiming here is to provide a client that will enable doing secure zero-touch provisioning of devices into your solution. And finally, the third pillar is about connectivity. And as part of this, we are going to work on deep integrations between Anjay and the Xcube Cellular, which is another component that STMicro is providing, in a way to collect or like get deeply into the connectivity metrics in order to understand them and provide the most efficient communication that takes into account the connectivity metrics in order to provide a really, really efficient solution for the STMicro developers. And the counterpart of Anjay, as we mentioned, is our Coiote IoT DM server. And then, as with Anjay, there are three main pillars that Coiote is built around. First of them is interoperability. By interoperability, we mean that our Coiote can work with as many lightweight machine-to-machine clients as possible. So we say, first of all, lightweight machine-to-machine should be interoperable by design because it's an open standard. And we really treat this interoperability as a very important thing in order to allow, to enable, you know, a seamless as possible onboarding of devices. So in order for the customer to minimize the time to connect devices. And as part of this, we are, for example, running this interoperability program together with AT&T. And as part of this, of the OMA Spec Work Test Fests, the yearly annual event during different providers of lightweight machine-to-machine solution are providing the client and the server in order to test their interoperability. For the last couple of years, we have scored the highest number in the category of interoperability. Second pillar is about usability. So for usability, we think about how to make the solution as usable for the customers as possible. So we are introducing the functionalities of lifecycle management, power saving, device provisioning, ops center to facilitate work of the ops people responsible for making sure that the solution is stable and working, and also straightforward integrations with third-party systems. Especially here, we provide the connector to the Azure IoT Hub, Azure IoT Central solutions, which allows management of lightweight machine-to-machine devices from Microsoft's Azure services, and the same for AWS IoT Core. Finally, scalability, the third pillar. The solution has been deployed already in major telco infrastructures. What we are very proud of and what has been emphasized during this year's Machination IoT Device Management Scorecard is our superior capabilities for grouping devices, which allows a customer, user of the platform to efficiently manage devices at the large scale using really simple workflows. So when we talk about building devices, this is one aspect, but also what is very important is to have the solutions for device provisioning, and not the device provisioning for a single device, but large scale device provisioning. By doing this, there is a need to provide the communication credentials on the device in an efficient way, and there is a need to reduce the operational complexity deployment. However, when we look at the currently available market options, the popular solutions that are used, like globally shared PSK, are not secure, and there are very few standardized mechanisms available. So, interesting combination that Anjay and Coiote together can provide is the secure device provisioning. And as part of this, we see we have a device manufacturers, we have these very popular device provisioning solutions, Azure, AWS, third party PKIs. And we may have lightweight machine to machine devices. These devices are cellular sometimes, so they have SIM card access. They can have also trusted hardware in the form of HSM or TE. And then since our Anjay is integrated with all of these solutions, it is capable of talking and storing credentials securely. We have our Coiote IoT DM server that has the capability to be integrated with different device provisioning solutions as well. And then a device manufacturer can have, you know, securely communicating with our Coiote platform in order, you know, to let us know, inform us about the devices that they are manufacturing, providing some sort of credentials. And then these credentials can be used through Anjay by these devices in order to securely be provisioned for Azure DPS, AWS IoT Core solutions, or any third-party PKI, or even device provisioning within the Coiote DM platform itself. All in all, it's about the solution that enables you to define your own provisioning processes. The second important thing that quite a lot of customers ask about is about, you know, this efficiency, especially device to cloud communication. What is important to know is this NB-IoT and LTE-M are growing like still very early solutions. And as far they are enabling new business models, especially in this smart metering vertical and so on, that have not been possible before. And there are no ready-made available solutions in the cloud, especially for device management for them. So as part of it, what we are offering, the Coiote DM is offering a solution that is translating lightweight machine to machine into the AMQP, MQTT, or REST that is being supported by major cloud provider solutions like Microsoft Azure or AWS IoT. So we are having the connector that basically enables management of lightweight machine to machine devices from the native AWS Azure application services. And this is not any proof of concept solutions or anything like this. It has been already deployed in a one major telecommunication infrastructure. Now, back to Anjay and how Anjay can be integrated into the STM32 ecosystem. If we have started with understanding the core values of the STM32 cube: accessibility, easy to use, and expandable. And in terms of access being accessible, Anjay is written on the open source license with Apache 2.0, so very permissive license. We are providing integration of the Anjay with the STM32 development environment. We are going to demonstrate it in a moment. There is a community support that AVSystem provides for STM32 developers. And something that we are very proud of is our recently launched IoT Developer Zone, which describes for developers, provides lots of tutorials about how to quickly prototype solutions for lightweight machine-to-machine, especially here with the focus on the STM32 ecosystem. In terms of easy to use, we are already providing on GitHub our ready-made open source integrations. They can be considered reference implementations that can be used as a starting point for your solutions that require just some probably tweaks and adaptations in order to be used. And finally, we are going to focus on the out-of-the-box functionality, for example, in the form of FOTA using, for example, MCU boot that can be again taken as a component and inserted as a ready-made solution that can cut your development time needed for doing this. And in terms of expandable, the solution that we are providing is production ready, and we are also it's already integrated with other STM32 components, and we will keep on working further in order to put it into as many places within the STM32 environment as possible to facilitate the development of development for the STM32 engineers. So right now I'd like to introduce the main star of this event, and this is a component, the package that we called iCube Anjay. And iCube Anjay is the combination of our Anjay together with Xcube Cellular, together with lightweight IP network stack and embed TLS. At the moment, it is available in this pre-release phase in our GitHub. However, in the coming days, weeks, it hopefully will be also available as part of the STM32 offering once it passes the final checks and review process on the STM side. What are the key features about it is that it will be part of the STM CubeMX offering. It is an exemplary code that shows how to run it in the STM32 ecosystem, ready-to-go package, and it's also a configurable lightweight machine-to-machine client available from the STM32 CubeMX. So right now, I'd like to now give my voice to my colleague Mieszko, who is going to demonstrate how iCube Anjay is going to work in action. So Mieszko, now the floor is yours.
Okay, so hello everyone. I will share my screen now so you can see what I'm doing. Okay, it should be visible by now. First, we'll start with the iCube Anjay. Currently, it's a preview package, so you can download it from our public GitHub repository. This is a preview package because it still requires some configuration from the end user to make it run, but it's fully functional and all features from the library are present and it's ready to go working. So, starting with it, you will have to download the repository so that you have a pack file. Then you will open the CubeMX, and here you can install or remove embedded packages. So from the local, you search for the pack that you downloaded and you have to install it. License is Apache 2.0, so it's free to use. Okay, now it's installed. We will start with a new project. With me, I have an L496 board from the ST. It features the BG6996 modem, and I will show you how to use it with our example. So there is some QNX setup that you have to make. We will start with this part. First things first, we have to select the correct board. And start the project with it. We don't want to initialize the peripherals. We don't need everything working here. Just the minimal bar. Okay, now we can add our software pack. We press select components, and here we select iCube Anjay. We have a few components here. First is the Anjay library itself. We want to enable it. We also want to enable support for the BG96 modem, also the exemplary application and the board support, so that we will have all the sensors available as lightweight machine-to-machine objects. After we enable the pack, we have to enable the I2C so that we can use the sensors and UART drivers, so for the communication with modem and locks. We also enable the global interrupts. It's all described in the README, so you can just follow the procedure there. We need the LNG module activated for the security. And from middleware, we use FreeRTOS with version 1. In the FreeRTOS, we have to increase the stack size so that xkubeserver that dynamically allocates the memory will work, and enable the counting semaphores. Okay, so now that now we go into the pack configuration, we have to enable all the components that we selected previously. And here is the client settings and parameter settings. Parameter settings are the all the settings from the library, like enabling the logging and support for different download types or maximum sizes of buffers. Also, you can enable modules like firmware update, bootstrap module, security server, etc. And in the client settings, it's basic settings that will be used for the connection. So here we will put webinar demo. In the PSK, we'll put test. And for the PSK identity, we'll also put webinar demo. Here is the default TryNJ server that is available freely and publicly. You just have to register and you can use it. I will use our internal server that we'll use for tests. And for the APN, I'm currently using the iBasis SIM card, so I will use it. And now we just have to go to the project and also check that we want to generate peripheral initialization as pairs of C and H files per peripheral. Choose it as an STM32 cube IDE and save it. We will create a new folder. Okay. And the last thing is to select the time source for the time-based source so that FreeRTOS works correctly. Now we just wait as the QMX does everything for us. Okay, we see that our project has been successfully imported. Here it is. Here we can see that there are a few files added, like app Anjay, which contains all the initialization code for the library, as well as object installation that chooses objects based on the board which are available and installs it and updates it. There are also places for to initialize user objects, and there is the process function which is updated every second and is used to update the object states. Anjay also requires to use the standard C and printer floats, so we'll apply and close it, and we will run it as an STM32 application. So currently it will be compiling it, and in the meantime I will show you how to add it to the Coiote DM server. So we will go to the Coiote Device Management. Starting from the start, you will see the login screen where you put your username and password that you get from the registration. Okay, here you will see your list of devices. If you have any previous ones, we will go to the device list and add a new device. It's currently working slower because of the compilation on my PC, but it shouldn't affect it that much. And now we'll add a new device. There are a few options to use here. You can connect via the Bootstrap server if you want to use secure, if you want to securely connect to the servers. Also, through the Bootstrap server, it is used in the production. Also, you can use our Anjay Lightweight Machine to Machine client that is basic application for Linux and allows for quickly set up Anjay. And you can also connect directly to the VR management server, and we'll choose that option. So we'll put here the webinar demo as a device ID. We use security mode PSK, and for here we use test, same options as we used with the software parking cube. Okay, we press add device. And here we will also get the URL that shows where should we connect it. Here we see that the demo has been built. And now we will upload it to our device. Okay, it will take a second to load. In the meantime, I will show you what else is in the iCubeNJ package. Here is the main application files just as I showed you, with the NJ configuration that is generated from the cube. Here you can set the different things that I shown you before in the parameter settings. But also, there are a few drivers included for the modem and also for the BSP for STM32L496. Okay, here we see that the download was successful. Here I have the open COM port with the board. And now we will wait for the cellular communication to get online. It is using the BG96, so for the NB-IoT or Cat2M1 network, it will take a few seconds for it to join. Okay, we see that it is starting now. I'm hearing that there are a lot of questions coming. I will try to answer them after the presentation. Okay, the network is up, and now the device is registering and sending its information to the server about what objects it's containing and other things. So if we go to the Coiote, we see that we can now go to the device. Okay, here is the webinar demo. We see that It has a serial number generated from the hardware IDs on the device, its address for the co-ops, and last uplink and downlink operations here. In the objects tab, we can check what objects are on the device. The standard objects like server and device, which are contained in every client. But there is also support for all the sensors that are currently on the board. And here is the temperature sensor, for example, we can read its value. Yeah, we can schedule a reading its value, so it will check the current value from the device, as well as for accelerometers and other values. If the value is small, it displays it like this. Okay, so the demo is working now. There are also other options like value tracking. We can set up to monitor data, for example, to notify us of every change per 10 minutes. So the tracking and the Coiote will do everything, all the rest. What can we do with this? There are integrations with AVS Azure Cloud, with both AVS and both Azure Cloud, so it can be streamed further by the Coiote. And you can play with all of it by yourself, just by downloading the application and playing with it. So that will be all for this part of presentation. I think I will give my voice back to Marcin.
Hello again. Okay, can you see my screen?
Yes.
Okay. So we talked about development, how this facilitates development. The second step about after you are developing is about testing. And here we come in handy to help developers with doing the integration tests. So the concept is that after every commit that you make, there is a CI pipeline that is building your package. Then usually there are unit tests that are being run. In terms of unit tests, the aspects that are concerning lightweight machine-to-machine functionalities are already unit tested as part of Anjay. So you don't need, and the way we are enabling these functionalities is really trivial. So you don't need to worry about doing unit tests for lightweight machine-to-machine part if you are using Anjay. However, what is interesting is about the next step, which is about the integration test. And here our Coiote platform enables you to very quickly write quite complex integration tests that can be integrated into your CI pipeline. So whenever you are making a commit, the package is built, then the integration tests can be run against our Coiote platform, and then you can get the result if it has passed or it has failed. If it has passed, then it can go to the next phase of the code review for your team before you get enough of confidence to deploy your solution to production. Mieszko, again, now this is your part to demonstrate it.
Okay, so I'm sharing my screen again. Okay. So I will show some of our internal projects. There is the Anjay FreeAutos client. It is based on the Xcube Solar package and CubeMX. It was the previous solution for the STM32 development, previous to iCube Anjay. There are some automatic pipelines that are triggered on every commit. So if we go to the CI/CD pipelines, we can see that there is a lot of them running. Okay. So here we will check what is happening. All the projects in the our integration are built there, and the interoperability tests, which Marcin was talking about. If we go into the logs, we can see that there are logs from the device where it is registering and it's communicating with the server, and what actually is happening here is uploaded to the test reports. And what those tests look like. In the server simulator tests, those are test cases that are executed on our devices. So, for example, there are some common test cases that we use. In the temperature case, if we look into it, there are a few read, execute, and write attributes actions. So for read, we check that the sensor units are correct, what are the max measured values, minimum measured values, if we reset those, if they are still correct, what are the sensor values, and we check all the real operations that lightweight machine-to-machine server will perform with the device after it has been deployed into the world. So you can use it in your CI. It uses REST API, and it can be fully automated to check if your device is fully working and ready for production. Those are certified tests that are used by many companies out there. So that's all from me, and back to Marcin.
And hello again. Thank you, Mieszko. So all in all, just you know, to sum it up, since we are already almost over with the time, and we hope you know to have still some Q&A. So apologies for speaking longer than expected. What Coiote DM offers is this, you know, easy device management. Well, all of these functionalities of onboarding, configuration, over-the-air services, diagnostics, lifecycle management are already available. And they are enriched with the capabilities of grouping, providing extensive API, and also very flexible workflow organization that allow you to tackle, hopefully, any problem that your solution might be facing. So this is all what we have prepared for today in terms of presentation and demonstration. However, now we would like to encourage everyone to ask questions, and we are will be delighted to answer them. Bartek, I think now you are taking lead in this part.
Yeah, exactly, Marcin, and thank you very much for this presentation. It was really great. Thanks also, Mieszko, for really an impressive demo. We already passed time, but I can see that we have quite a few questions, so we're going to take a few of them. And the rest we're going to take offline via email. So don't worry, we have your questions and they're going to be answered. We have one question from Mia. Isn't there any integration on the STM32WLEX from the MCU series?
Okay, so I think I can answer that. IQ Anjay package can be run on any STM32 there, but we still don't have integration with the LoRa part on this series. So we plan on doing integration with LoRa part, but it is in the future.
Great, Mieszko, thank you. We also have a question from David. Will we see the cloud integration side, Azure, AWS?
Okay, I will take it. Not during this webinar event today. Probably, you know, we can organize a separate event to talk about it. Here we focus mostly about facilitating job for the device developer and encourage them not to be afraid about lightweight M2M. The AWS Azure we will take at some other time.
Yeah, and it seems a bit like a follow-up question. We have a question from Maya. How do you integrate with AWS and Azure? Is the connection bidirectional?
Yes. So the communication is bidirectional. So in the interest of time, I can briefly describe maybe the solution for Microsoft Azure. So as part of this, they are offering multiple ways of communicating. There is a direct method. There is device-to-cloud communication. And there are device twins options. And what we are doing is we are allowing lightweight machine-to-machine device to connect to Coiote as if normally over lightweight machine-to-machine server, normally over lightweight machine-to-machine connection. However, the Coiote server has the ability to map the request into one of the methods that are being supported by Microsoft Azure. So for example, if the device is sending telemetry data, it will be mapped to a device to cloud communication option. And if the device is just updating one of its properties within the data model, then it's going to be the device coins options and so on. The important thing here is that Microsoft Azure communicating over AMQP or MQTT is not enforcing any type of data model. So this enforcing the data model for Microsoft Azure, or the same holds for AWS, is a challenge. So what we are introducing here, we are introducing a template of the data model for a device that we ask the device manufacturer that wants to operate it from the Microsoft Azure to provide, in a way that we understand if a particular method that is being invoked is a telemetry, then it's about mapping into the efficient way of communication with the Microsoft Azure cloud. The same concept, the same idea are for AWS. And I hope this answers the questions on the very high level. If not, I'm also very happy to talk about it.
Yeah, we have another one from Maya. So does the customer do the mapping from the lightweight M2M model to the Azure AWS data model themselves?
Well, so there are two options. If you want to have a really efficient solution, yes, you need to collaborate a little bit in order to at least let us know which part is telemetry, which are its properties, which are just executable methods to do. If not, you know, we can be pushing JSONs to Microsoft Azure and letting you live with this.
Right. We have another question from Thomas. How does solution work with Sierra FX30 solution?
Mieszko, can you help it here? Sierra FX30 solution?
If Sierra is still stasi as just a for Gamal IoT gateway, if you use it as a gateway to the existing application, you can just run Anjay on the Linux device or any other embedded device as the LWM2M stack that communicates over sockets. For the programmable solution that is going inside the Sierra, we don't have any ready to go integrations, but it can be run pretty much everywhere because it uses plain C. So I think that it will be possible to do it.
Okay, I'm really sorry, but we are running out of time. So thank you so much for your engagement. I see that we have still quite a few questions here. So we're gonna reach out to you via email. Also, if you have any more questions, feel free to reach out to the speakers directly or to AVSystem, and we will be happy to answer them. Thank you once again so much for joining us today. And I would also like to extend my thanks to the speakers. Thank you so much. Great job, guys.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thanks, everybody. Thanks for being with us.
Thank you. Goodbye.